there, Alaskans, wherever you are. Welcome to the Must Read Alaska Show. Coming to you from somewhere in Alaska. This is the place where we talk about, you guessed it, Alaska. Where we keep the mainstream media on their toes and where we are standing up for what's right in a world run by leftists. You can find out more by heading over to MustReadAlaska.com and also checking out the Must Read Alaska YouTube channel for some really great content. But first, let's get this party started.
Welcome, everybody, to the Must Read Alaska Show. I'm your host, John Quick, coming to you live from somewhere in Alaska. I hope everybody's having a phenomenal summer so far. I know I have. We went 20 days or so camping in our RV with 17 family and friends all over Alaska, went 1,000 miles, hiked about 60 miles, walked or hiked about 60 miles around those campgrounds and whatnot, and we've had a blast. I hope everybody else in Alaska is doing the same. We want to thank everybody that listens, watches, and reads Must Read Alaska. We do this to spread conservative news through all the nooks and crannies of Alaska. If you want to help keep the lights on here at Must Read Alaska, we're not funded by some dark web nonprofit money conglomerate. We're just funded by everyday folks who care about conservative news in Alaska. You go to MustReadAlaska.com. On the right-hand side, there's a little donate button. Every $5, $10, even $100 helps. So if you already do that, we want to thank you for being partnered with us. And without further ado, we have a very special guest today, Mayor Dave Bronson of Anchorage. Welcome to the Must Read Alaska Show, Mayor.
John, my friend, good to talk to you again. And it's my honor being on the your premier blog. I'd like to say that maybe on a correction there, you said you're interested, you know, your listeners are interested in conservative news. My experience with Must Read is that it's those people that are actually interested in just the truth. And I think the truth doesn't have a political viewpoint. It's just the truth. But maybe I'm too much of a purist or something. But that's what I've always appreciated about what Suzanne has done, is she gets to the truth. And the truth is what it is. So, but anyways, happy to be here. You guys are doing a fantastic job.
Well, I appreciate it. You've hit the two-year mark. I think that's very exciting. You came in a very tumultuous time where you had a previous mayor had resigned. There had been an interim mayor. And I think Anchorage was looking for a new direction, a direction from a leader who cared about businesses. As folks can remember, during COVID, the previous mayor who had resigned had basically locked down Anchorage and, you know, shattered and shut down businesses. And Mayor, you came in there and you were the "we are open for business" mayor, much like Charlie Pierce was here on the Kenai Peninsula. And so you've hit the two-year mark. Talk to us about some of the strides you've made. Let's go into public safety first. Tell us about public safety, how that's been, some of the things that you and your team have accomplished and some of the things you're excited about as it relates to public safety.
Right. Well, as you kind of allude to, public safety is the single most important thing and the greatest responsibility, I think, of government. And so I'm a big supporter of the police, excuse me, the police and fire departments. We've got some fantastic chiefs of both police and fire. They're doing a great job. You know, our manpower on the police side is a little bit short. It's pretty clear to us that this defund the police movement around the country has harmed our recruiting and our retention. You know, these police officers are quite frankly heroes to me. And when they're condemned in public, when they're you know, cursed at in public and even attacked in public, that's an attack on the very fiber of our society. And I won't stand for it. I support our police officers. And I bring to them the funding that they need. I make them hold to a budget, but I'm pretty generous. And I believe we need to get up to full manning at the police department. The fire department, they don't have as great a challenge on the recruiting and retention. We have got we have a class A fire department here, and the chief. Chief Schrock, he somehow has this unique skill of bringing in federal and state money to our fire department, and which offsets in some of the property taxes. So when people see increased funding on the fire department, because of these grants that he can somehow magically get. Compliment him when you see him, because that helps to reduce property taxes. And that's a good thing, obviously. And because one of the parameters within which I must operate is to lower property taxes. And we do that by trimming government. We do that, I think, effectively here. We're now actually facing a situation where a lot of our departments are undermanned, and a lot of that's due to, in fact, most of it's due to the state raising pay scales over there, and we've got people leaving for the state and leaving for private enterprise. And we are losing some real key people, and so we're ramping up our recruitment and retention efforts, and especially at the police department. That is the most honorable work you can imagine in any society, being a police officer. And we need to, I remember 30 years ago, I applied to the Anchorage Police Department, went through much of the process. And I think on our first day, sitting at the Egan Center, taking that very first test, there was about 1,100 or 1,200 people in the room. And now the chief is telling me we could be down to 50 or 60 applying. And then with the problems with, you know, maybe previous drug use and everything else, we're struggling to fill the academies, and we're keeping it at, we've got it. We're trying to fill our two academies a year. We've been doing that. I support that wholeheartedly. But I think the young men and women in this city and need to understand this is honorable work. It's greatly appreciated in Anchorage. And to if you think there's anything in your future that would suggest public service as a matter being a police officer, please apply to the Anchorage Police Department. We have a good benefits package. We do very well. And I just can't encourage you enough if you're interested in public service and a great career.
So let's hit on one more thing on public safety. You are becoming very technology savvy with your city as it relates to public safety. Tell me about this new app that you all are a part of or maybe developed that detects heart attacks. This is fascinating.
Well, it's what it is. It's called Pulse Point. It's a life-saving free app. It is what it does. It notifies users when someone in their area has a heart attack. It's kind of a geofencing thing. And notifies people and that there is a heart attack in the area. And then if the person who is notified is, you know, CPR trained, they can rush to that person. And of course, all of our fire department folks, when they're on duty, off duty, they're on that. It's pretty innovative. Chief Shragi, again, led that effort. He brought them on board with his team. It's a lifesaver. The numbers are actually pretty impressive. It's in Anchorage is what it does. The number of it increased the number of people that have heart attacks. The survival rate increased by 13 percentage points to over a 57% survival rate of heart attacks. And keep in mind, for perspective, the national average is only 34%. So this thing, this app, is saving lives nearly every day. And that we've got one of the finest EMS agencies in this system in the country by far. And this app really contributes to that. So again, kudos to the fire department. Kudos to Chief Shragi and his executive team for bringing this on board and executing on it. So we're quite proud of him and his department.
That's awesome. Well, let's shift gears for a second. And one of the things that was important to you as you came into office was good governance. I think the folks in Anchorage mm-hmm. saw things from the previous mayor that probably just weren't up to par. They didn't pass the kind of the sniff test. There was rumblings of during COVID when he was shutting down businesses with the assembly that, you know, allegedly some of the restaurants that he was a part of, well, they could stay open, but the other ones couldn't. And so I think as you came into office, good governance was something that you took very seriously. So talk to us about some of the policies and steps that you all and you and your team have taken towards good governance.
Well, certainly reducing the footprint of government is important. I'm a conservative with a strong libertarian sense, I guess, to me, or an ethos. When it comes to COVID, yeah, COVID was very important to all of us. A lot of businesses were driven out of business, not by COVID directly, but by the shutdowns and the rules associated. I took a different stance. I eliminated to the degree that I could all the COVID restrictions. We were, you know, doing mandatory masking. The meta-analysis now of all the studies, masking did not stop the spread of, or didn't slow the spread of COVID transmission. It just didn't. But there is a place for masks in certainly in the surgical world, and when they're used professionally by people trained in PPE. My thing is, and maybe I had the advantage of 24 years serving in the military, but I am instinctively extremely cautious when the government comes in and tells you to do something, inject something into your body or do this or that. So I had this instinctive questioning about when the government tells me to do something. And the military would do that. They'd say, back in, 2003, they would come in and say, all right, it's time to go to the Middle East. We're going to start getting in line and we're going to pump a lot of drugs into you. And I was in the Air National Guard at the time. And I says, with the autoimmune issues related to all that, I don't think it's government's job to compel that kind of stuff without a lot of thought. And, and the vaccine gave me great pause. And in fact, I brought up a team of experts. They sat in my office in multiple meetings. I got to spend, in fact, the gentleman who invented the mRNA technology that allowed for a couple of the vaccines, he had great questions. And it turns out it was good he questioned. So I followed a body of thought that we need to be real cautious and on what we put into our bodies in an untested vaccine. And because, so people know, the big numbers are normally a vaccine has to be tested for 7 to 10 years, multiple cycles of whatever it's trying to prevent against, say the flu or something else. Well, this one was put in a matter of weeks. And I understand, I'm not picking political sides. I understand President Trump at the time, he ordered it and he wanted to move. So whether it was he or President Biden that forced it, that's not the point. The point is we need to be cautious. And more importantly, I think as a libertarian, is that the government doesn't have the right to tell you to put a vaccine into your body, to compel you to do that. I was stridently against that. So as we came into office and I entered office and started talking to our employees, I had multiple employees, especially in police and fire, came to me and says, thank you for not compelling us to get that vaccine because I was going to quit if you were to compel that. And I think some people voted for me simply because of that. My job is I didn't do that for votes. I did it because it was the right thing to do. On the other side, through my health department, I provided vaccines and I provided masks and all that kind of stuff. Because as a conservative or libertarian, if you want a vaccine, I will provide it. If you don't, I'm not going to compel it. And I think that's government's proper role, is to provide information and to provide opportunities, but compelling us to do something in the sense of forcing a vaccine, I had real problems with that, and I had experience with that, and I wasn't going to go there. That's not government's place. So anyways, get the best government is the government that governs least, and that's been an ethos of mine all my adult life. So I stuck with that once I got into office.
Nice. Well, yeah, I think, the extreme views of, you have to get a vaccine and you have to get 10 boosters, or, you know, nobody gets a vaccine, nobody should get a vaccine. I think people forgot that there's a middle road where if you want to get a vaccine and 20 boosters, go for it. Just
right.
Tell me I have to do the same. I'll just do whatever I want. You do whatever you want and we'll call it good. And I think that that's the beauty of America, is that we should be able to have those different viewpoints and opinions on things, whether it's vaccines or schools or whatever, and be fine with not landing on the same page. And so I appreciate your viewpoint. Talk to me a little bit about you guys got some sort of a big grant, I want to say, and I'm pulling it up here because I wrote myself.
Oh, for the port?
Yes, the port. So you guys, let's talk a little bit about the port, because I think you broke some sort of a record. You got the biggest appropriation, at least that anybody could remember, maybe even in the history of appropriations. Talk to me about the port, why it's so important that we fix it. You know, I think that most people don't realize that when they go to Walmart or Fred Meyer or Three Bears or Costco, these goods, you know, we just kind of take for granted that these goods show up on a shelf. Well, it takes a lot of work to get those goods to be on the shelf. Port of Anchorage is usually behind most of that. So why is the Port of Anchorage so important? And what are some exciting things that you've done the last couple of years about it?
Right. Let's start with that, with the importance of the port. 90-95% of the citizens of this state are fed, supplied. Everything you get comes over that port, that dock. And the dock is failing. It's approaching the end of its service life. So real short, the engineering, I'm a detail guy, but I'll keep this simple. The dock is supported by a bunch of columns, steel columns that are not filled with concrete and rebar. They're just metal pipes stuck down in the ground, some of them approaching 200 feet stuck into the ground. And they're failing. They're corroding, for lack of a better phrase. And so if when you get to a very low tide, you look at these columns and there's a bandwidth of about, I don't know, roughly 10 feet where the corrosion is extreme. And to the point where you can see through, there's holes through them. When they drain, the water just kind of comes out of them. And it's very serious. So look at it like it is. Our food is dependent on a structure that's completely failed or is in at risk of completely failing. The earthquake we had a few years ago, had it gone 7 more seconds, the engineers subsequently told us the port would have failed. And when I mean fail, it would fall off downhill into the water. If that happens, we've got a big problem, because now you've got to bring in ships to remove that before you can rebuild the dock to supply. So we're back to really old school, you know, folks like, Jim Jansen over at Linden. And our shippers would probably be bringing in food on barges to the beaches, and we'd be offloading that way. We'd get a little bit from Seward and Whittier. But all the ports combined do not have the capacity of that port. And that port, people say, well, we'll just do a Berlin airlift kind of thing and we'll do that. You can't. That's not possible, because those four ships, two on Sunday, two on Tuesdays from Tote and Matson, when that cargo, that equivalent would be the same as equivalent of 700 747 cargo flights.
That's never going to happen.
Well, those aircraft don't exist. And every, I spent 18 years flying 747 cargo aircraft for Northwest Airlines. I have a sense of that business. That capacity doesn't exist. And no one's going to give up their, you know, Lower 48 gets their cargo shipments on set from 747s from Asia or wherever. They're not going to give up their capacity. Cargo, so it's not going to happen. So this is an Alaska problem specifically. It's an Anchorage problem, and the port is managed and controlled by the mayor, who happens to be me right now. Now to the program, we have a port modernization program that's been in effect for quite a few years now. And when I came into office, it was being managed. This $2 billion construction project was being managed, I thought, by the wrong people. It was being managed by our employees, our port employees, who have a great deal of experience managing a port. They have zero experience in building a port. It's two different, completely different things. And managing a port, which they do extremely well, has to happen as we build the port. So I came in, I looked at it, and this happened within a few weeks. I went to the engineering company that was working for our municipality as a contractor, Jacobs Engineering. I says, I think you guys need to be building this port, not me. And they says, we've been asking for this for years. And I said, okay, it's yours. And I'm going to monitor your progress. I'm going to hire engineering firms to monitor you. And if you screw up, I'll fire you and find another company to build the port. And he says, thank you very much. Well, we're back on track. We're actually a little bit ahead of now of the construction schedule. Jacobs is doing a great job at doing that. The port management team is, they're up to their neck in the management because it's like completely remodeling your house as you live in your house. And that's what our port management team is challenged with. So we've started on several of the phases. We've already standing up the new administration building because the previous one is built on the dock. That's the last place in a modern. It was good when it was originally built many years ago. Now it doesn't work because dock space is so valuable. Back then, we didn't have containers and all the cargo had to come through our building to be checked. Well, we don't do that. When the container comes off a ship, it's attached to a truck with wheels, and it's brought immediately to Costco, Fred Meyer's, all the retail, you know, Three Bears. And it's absolutely a miracle when you watch these two companies offload ships and how fast they can do it. It's a work of art. It's almost like watching operations on an aircraft carrier. It's that precise. So anyways, we're moving the port administration building. We're stabilizing the north end of the docks. You know, the old sheet pile issue that we had several years ago. The sheet piles buckled during the driving them in, and during the tide cycles, soil was leaching out into the current, which caused sinkholes way back from the water line. So that's in it. And with bigger ships now coming in with tote and mats, and we need to get that peninsula, for lack of a better phrase, of land out of the way. We're removing that. We're salvaging that gravel, and hopefully to be used with other projects. Someone thought it might be a good idea to take it out in the inlet and dump it. And I says, we don't waste that kind of resource. We paid a lot of money for that gravel, and we're going to store it, and we're going to reuse it. So the folks know, we have two docks in the port project, the port reconstruction project. When the first one is stood up, so when we have a seismically secure dock, the first one, that is food security. Because we really want to get to two docks, don't get me wrong, because we want to be able to offload two ships at a time, like we're doing, two on Sundays and two on Tuesdays. But if we get one dock stood up that's seismically secure, and then we have an earthquake and the other dock fails, we're going to be okay, because we will just sequence those four ships one day at a time throughout the week. We have that scheduling capability. And that's what our port manager would do. And of course, that has long-term effects, because there's an entire infrastructure in Seattle and Tacoma and the entire Northwest, which supplies us. They're built on two ships twice a week. If they had to change, you know, for eggs and milk and things like that, if they had to change, that would be a big thing, but they would change because we need the stuff. So, and the good news is the PCT, the petroleum cement terminal, is up and running. We've had a couple, three ships through there now. So we have a seismically secure dock for petroleum and for cement. That big dome you see out there, that's our cement storage facility. And so we're well on our way. The port management team, the port construction team, they've done great work. And my job is to get as much money as I can from state and federal. We've already chipped in as a municipality the tune of $165 million in revenue bonds. But it's a $2 billion project. And late 2025, whoever's mayor at that time is going to have to make the decision about how we're going to fund the rest of it. And that will be through revenue bons, which are paid for by the ton through surcharges. And we can do that. We're at about $3.40 a ton right now. I don't want to go higher than that. However, to put it into perspective, Hawaii, Honolulu is about $35 a ton. And they still are economically viable, but it does add to the cost per ton of everything that comes over. So if we can stack the capital now, which is we're working at a feverish pace to do that with the legislature and the federal government. And that's the $70 million you mentioned. That helps with that. And of course, thanks to Senator Sullivan and Senator Murkowski, we got that money. Their team did great jobs in getting us that. And we did. We got the single largest port grant of any port in the country, more than Los Angeles and Florida, Jacksonville. We did well in that. So say thanks to Senator Sullivan's staff and Senator Murkowski's staff. They did yeoman's work.
That's awesome.
So we're well on our way. And my thing is food security. There's nothing more important in my world than food security. And that's what that project gets us.
So as the mayor, you're in charge of the port that brings goods or service goods to, 90% of the population in Alaska. So is it fair to say, let's say, it's hypothetical, but we're in the middle of winter, there's a huge earthquake, that happens. You and I both know those things happen. Let's say the port goes down. Is that a national emergency? I mean, is it a catastrophic emergency that's going to happen if the port were to go down because of an earthquake in the middle of the winter?
Well, it would be the only conversation that we would have in this state. I met with a senior personal friend of Secretary Buttigieg's who works at the Department of Transportation. He gets it. He says that is an instantaneous humanitarian crisis. Those are his words, not mine. And the DOT is helping us. They're supporting us. We're reaching out to every last federal agency for support because we do not have food security right now. If we had an earthquake, the 4.6 we had the other day, had that been a 7.1 and gone 40 or 50 seconds, we would have been in really... The thing to remember is that if the port collapses, our best guess is not less than half the population of the state will have to leave the state because there's no food. And that sentence is really important. Because there's no food, a lot of people are going to have to go to home to Lower 48 or wherever to where the food is until government and all the partners can stand up and get that port stood up so we can figure out a delivery mechanism anywhere from Cordova to Homer to over the road through Canada. But this will, we saw shortages in our grocery stores this past winter, the supply chain interruption thing. That will be nothing compared to what will be here if that port collapses. And I know to the people of Anchorage, especially, the homeless thing is important. Economic development is important. To me, from what I see, there's nothing more important than getting a seismically secure dock for food delivery at the Port of Anchorage. It's simply that simple. There's nothing more important in the state than that. Not pipelines, not homelessness, not PFDs. because I see the threat. In fact, I didn't understand myself how severe the threat was until I came into office. And then, you know, you get briefings when you first come in. And I was briefed on this, and I go, that issue went from about second or third, maybe even fourth on my list, to number one with a distant number two.
And, yeah, and, you know, for folks listening that are independents or Democrats or liberals or Republicans or libertarians that are listening to this, let this sink in, because you might think homelessness should be the number one issue in Alaska and we got to shore this up and all that, or public safety or whatever. This is it. If the port goes down, you will have 100,000 to 200,000 people without food, without the ability to eat, and you'll see half of Anchorage leave the state very quickly. I mean, this will be one of the most craziest things that the United States will have ever have seen outside of, you know, something that happens after a hurricane or something like that. I mean, this is a major issue. And Mayor, I'm confident that you and your team are going to tackle it. You know, you've done the right things. You've worked with Senator Sullivan and Murkowski to secure funding. You've worked with the State House and the State Senate to secure funding.
Right.
You know, I hope that the Assembly sees the importance of this and continues to work with you, because this could be a, you know, cataclysmic event. And so I'm very thankful that you're hitting it head on and hopefully going to alleviate the ability for it to, you know, have one of those moments where it's the oh crap moment. You know, hopefully it's
right. Really, and John, be aware there's on this issue, we got a lot of politics in our city, like we have everywhere. That's how we do government. But on this, I don't think there's any space between myself and what I believe is the right path forward in the Assembly. I really don't. We understand the existential threat this port failure would pose to the state and to the city. But I do want to correct your numbers. 100,000 is probably light. We have 730,000, 90% of them are fed by this, and half of that, there's a lot of people. And it may be even more in that. Now, in this reconstruction project, you know, trying to remove the old port that's collapsed, because we know how it will fail. And if it fails, it'll fail downhill into the path where we need to bring build a new port. This could take over a year to get back to the capacity. Now, I have great faith in Tote and Mattson and Linden to come in and jury rig something where we could slowly start coming back. But this is a major, that's the only conversation. We will forget our conversations about our kids' hockey and baseball. We'll forget about homelessness. We'll forget about everything else if this thing fails. And if I do one thing in this job, and that is to get that thing stood up before we have an earthquake, then I will consider a great success in my life, because it was just a big problem sitting there that I think I was right. It wasn't being addressed correctly. I just realigned a few things. I built a good team to deal with it. And now we are on our way, and just hopefully there's no interruptions, political or economic or fiscal, but we are going to rebuild that port. We are just going to do it, no matter what it costs. And even if we have to get to the high end of the tariffs over time, it's not going to be, you know, or surcharges, I should be more accurate there. It's not catastrophic at all. It would be more expensive, and we're already expensive enough up here, but failure is not an option. We've got to move this forward, and I just hope there's no interruptions. And my job is to grease the skids so this process moves forward as quickly and as short a time frame as possible.
I like that. Well, we've went by 30 minutes, has went by in a flash. Any last minute thoughts before we head off here, Mayor?
Well, I've got great hope for our city. We've got a lot going on, Block 41 downtown. We've got some construction major construction projects throughout the city that we're going to get to announce. We're kind of under NDAs right now. Crime is down. We've created about 2,900 jobs since May of a year ago. Unemployment is very low. In fact, there's a shortage of workers, a critical shortage of workers. And then housing. We are working full speed ahead on making housing cheaper and more affordable and more plentiful. We've got to get government out of the way of the building of homes. We simply have to do that. And I've got a great team that's focused on that. We need to turn our real estate, whatever it is, buildings or just raw property, we've got to turn it into revenue-generating property that increases the tax base so that the property taxpayer has less of a burden on operating government. And that's my job. That's a key focus, and everything we do is filtered through that prism of reducing property taxes. And it's tough. It's real tough, but we'll get there.
Well, I appreciate you showing up to the Must Read Alaska show and wishing you nothing but success, Mayor Bronson, as your journey continues. And I think that you're on a good trajectory, and I'm really excited about you and your team fixing the port. That's going to be awesome. I think, like I said, you're on the right track there. You've garnered support from Sullivan and Murkowski and the State House and the State Senate and people on the Assembly. And I think that, you know, people will look back on your term there and be very excited that a businessman wanted to tackle this problem, because usually people would not want to tackle a problem this size. So thank you so much for your work. And you're welcome on anytime on the Must Read Alaska show. I want to encourage people to that listen, watch, and read Must Read Alaska. If you want to help keep the lights on here, go to mustreadalaska.com. On the right-hand side, there's a little donate button. Click on that. Every $5, $10 helps keep the lights on here at Must Read Alaska. If you're already doing that, I want to thank you for doing that. And until next time, I'm John Quick from somewhere in Alaska. Thank you, Mayor Bronson, for coming on the Must Read Alaska show.
Thanks, John.
Yep.